Okay, so as you all have completed your graduation, you have all studied these topics very well. So we'll be moving just with some speed, right? So that we can complete all the topics within a given time, right? Basically, what are bacteria? These are prokaryotic microorganisms. What do you mean by prokaryote? Pro means primitive, karyon means nucleus, right? And these are single-celled organisms and they are having DNA in the center, which is not bound by the nuclear membrane. Okay, so why you are calling it as primitive means the DNA or the nuclear material is not bound by the nucleus. That is why we are calling it as primitive nucleus or prokaryote. Okay, so nuclear membrane is absent. Other membrane bound organelles are also absent in bacteria, and these are having plasmids. Size will be very small and they are omnipresent. They are present everywhere and they are the oldest living organisms on earth. And you can find many number of bacteria per gram of soil. If you take small amount of soil, you can find millions of bacteria in that. And this is more than 10 times more bacteria in human body. Whatever is there in the nature, 10 times more bacteria is present in human body. So we are all dependent on the bacteria also. And why you have to study about bacteria? We like every experiment can't be done on human, right? We have to use different organisms for research. So this bacteria is one of them. And as the size is small, you can use it very easily, and they are helpful in fermentation, in nutrient recycling, like nitrogen cycling, carbon cycling, etc. And they are also helping in nitrogen fixation. And we know we are eating these microorganisms. For example, your mushrooms and single cell protein, and for degradation of many compounds or recycling of waste or degradation of pesticides, many things are being degraded by your microorganisms. Next slide. So this is the relative size of the bacteria. You can see this is the atom, next molecule, lipids, proteins, virus, bacteria, and so on. So as we are moving from left to right, the size is being increased, and at the top of the diagram, you can see the size in units, okay, whether it is nanometers, picometers, angstroms, anything. Okay, so after virus, there is a bacteria, and here, this part you have to see it under electron microscope, and this part you from here you can see it under light microscope. Means bacteria you can see under light microscope, virus you can't see under light microscope. You have to use electron microscope for this. Am I clear, ma? Next, sizes of bacteria. Spherical bacteria, as you know, there are different shapes. So when you are talking about size, that shape is also important. Spherical bacteria, if you take it, is ranging from 0.5 to 2 microns, and rod shaped is 1 to 10 microns in length and 0.25 to 1 microns in diameter. Spirochetes means spiral bacteria, which is ranging in size from 500 micrometers, and Epilobacterium fasciolani is the smallest bacteria, which is ranging from 600 micrometers into 80 microns in size. Mycoplasma gallisepticum, it is also a small one, 200 to 300 nanometers, and Thiomargarita namibiensis is one of the largest bacteria. It is measuring 0.1 to 0.3. mm in size. Shapes, what are the shapes? Cocci, you have rod shaped, bacillus, that is vibrio, and then spirillum is also there. Okay, so these are the shapes. If you go for cocci, these are the different arrangements. In arrangements, you can get the question. Diplococci, what is diplococci? What is staphylococci? Grape bunch arrangement. Streptococci means chain shaped. Sarcina means cuboid shaped. Tetrad means four shaped. Four cells arranged together. even you like they can even ask the example. Okay, these are the examples for that. And this is the bacillus arrangement. It may be coccobacillus. It is the intermediate between cocci and bacillus. And this is the single cell diplobacilli. Palisade means like matchsticks in a matchbox. They are arranged like this in palisade arrangement. And this is the streptobacilli where cells are arranged in the form of a chain. So bacillum, the word bacillum itself means rod shaped or stick shaped. Okay. Diplobacilli example is Corynebacterium diphtheria and Streptobacillus example is Streptobacillus monilliformis. Palisade arrangement is seen in diphtheria bacillus. So these examples you have to remember. Sometimes they may ask. Vibrio means comma shaped. Best example is Vibrio cholera bacteria, which is the causative agent of disease cholera. Spirillum. This is the spiral shaped one. Example is Trypanosoma pallidum. Other shapes are also there, like filamentous shape, square shape, rectangle shape, even star shape. Okay, this is polymorphic in nature, like different shapes you are able to see. Mycoplasma example, it is showing different shapes. Here filamentous nature is seen for Candidata savagella. This is the rectangular cells and these are the star-shaped cells with the examples. So this is the ultrastructure, ma. You can see, you have to remember this diagram. What is there from outer side? Sometimes they will ask, what is the outermost layer? Some cells, they will have capsule. Okay, below the capsule, there is a cell wall. So cell wall will be present in all the bacteria almost. Below the cell wall, cell membrane. Right? Below that, what is this? Cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, ribosomes will be there. In the center, DNA is there. Okay, inclusion bodies will be there. Plasmids will be there. On the outer side, villi are there. Flagella is there. Just now I have gone through some questions in that they are asking, what are the hair-like structures present on the cell wall or the bacterial cell? What is the answer? They are villi, not flagella. Flagella are very long. Villi are very short and covering the entire cell. Okay, these are the hair-like structures. Am I clear? Next. Coming to flagellama, you know this is used for motility of the bacteria. It is used as a taxonomic tool, means based on the presence of flagella, cells are or bacteria classified. Taxonomy means classification. Flagella consists of basal body, hook and filament. These are the different parts. Basal body, hook and filament. Function is movement. Okay. Here you can see. This is the hook. This is the filament. And whatever part is present in the cell wall, which is embedded in the cell wall, it is called as basal body. Okay. So in this basal body, they are having different structures. M ring, S ring, P ring, L ring. Okay, this is gram negative cell wall. This is gram positive cell wall. Okay, so different structures, different cells, they are having different structures of flagella. Okay, here P ring means it is present in the peptidoglycan. S ring means periplasmic space, it is present. M ring means membrane. L ring means lipopolysaccharide. Okay. So different membranes will have different rings in the flagellar basal body. That is why they are given different names. L ring, P ring, S ring, M ring. M ring means membrane. S ring means space, periplasmic space. P ring means peptidoglycan, L ring means lipopolysaccharide. Next. So monotrichus, lophotrichus, amphitrichus and peritrichus. Just now I have seen there is a question on this. What you call with the cell with two tufts of flagella. Okay. So what is the answer? Amphitrichus. Right? These are the examples. Next, pili. These are the short hair-like structures. They are present in gram-negative bacteria. They are made of pilin protein. They are small, short, and many in number. They are longer than fimbriae. Their formation is dependent on the genes present on the plasmids. They do not help in any motility. They can be removed mechanically. If they are removed also, they can rapidly form again. There are five to six types of pili. They are giving antigenic property, means if a bacteria is entering into our body will generate antibodies against pili. That is antigen. Fimbriae agglutinates with blood cells, means clumping whatever you are seeing there, it is helping. Fimbriae affects metabolic activity. Sex pili transfer genome conjugation, it is helping. And they are also helping in attachment. Capsule. If it is loosely bound, it is called as slime layer. If it is tightly bound, it is called as capsule. And it is helping in pathogenicity. Means it is helping in causing the disease in the bacteria. And polysaccharides. A capsule made of polysaccharides is present in these cells. And capsule made of polypeptides is present in these cells. So it can be made of any material. Next. So coming to the functions. As I told you, pathogenicity. It is able to cause the disease if a bacteria is having capsule. It helps from drying or desiccation. And it helps in excluding of bacterial viruses and toxins. Like it is protecting the cell from viruses and toxins. And for attaching to strange plant roots, teeth, tissue, and other bacteria. Like for causing a disease, bacteria should attach itself to some surface. So that attachment is done by capsule. They are species specific and they are acting as a buffer between external environment and the interior cell. Next, present beneath capsule protects from osmotic pressure and gives shape to. Okay, so cell wall, it is present beneath the capsule. Thickness is 100 to 250 angstroms. Bacteria are of two types based on presence of cell wall. It can be gram positive and gram negative. And this is the peptidoglycan structure. Peptidoglycan will have backbone, tetrapeptide side chain, and peptide interlink or crosslink or interbridge. This is the basic structure of the peptidoglycan. Backbone will consist of NAG and NAM, N-acetyl glucosamine and N-acetyl muramic acid sugars are present here. Both the layers are connected by tetrapeptide side chains. See, this is the NAG and NAM. These are the sugars. These sugars will have this tetrapeptide. This is the tetrapeptide, means four amino acids are there. That is why it is called as peptide. And see, this is the sugar layers, right? These are the adjacent layers. These two adjacent layers are attached by a cross link. Okay, this is the cross link or bridge, right? Here, this is the tetrapeptide. This is the tetrapeptide of this layer. This is the tetrapeptide of the above layer. Both these tetrapeptides are linked by a cross link, peptide cross link. Okay, this you have to remember. Next. So this is the gram positive cell wall. This is the gram negative cell wall. Just to see here, peptidoglycan will be the major difference one. Peptidoglycan is more here. Here it is very less. Here lipopolysaccharide layer is present. Here it is absent. Decoic acid is present in gram positive cells. It is absent here. Okay. Outer membrane is not there in gram positive cells. So these are the major differences. Here you can see cell wall. Which one is thick? Gram positive cells are thick, right? Here, lipid content is more in cell gram negative cells compared to gram positive cells. Cell wall has relatively low amino acids, and all the amino acids are present. Means amino acids are less in gram positive cells. One second. Next, muriatic acid peptidoglycan is more in gram positive cells. Teichoic acid is present in gram positive cells. Lipopolysaccharides are present in gram negative cells. Polar flagella are present in gram negative cells, sensitive to penicillin. Means gram positive cells can be killed by penicillin antibiotic, whereas gram negative cells, they are resistant to penicillin, but they are sensitive to streptomycin. These are the basic differences. And functions of cell wall, they give shape to the cell. They are acting as protective barriers from the environment, and lipopolysaccharide of gram negative cells will have antigenic specificity. These matrix proteins, which are present on the membrane, they are acting as receptors for nutrients, colonies, bacteriophages, etc. Protects the cell protoplast from mechanical damage and from osmotic rupture. If the cell is protected in the nature, it is majorly due to cell wall. Location of respiration, photosynthesis, lipid synthesis, etc. These enzymes are also present in the membranes. Next, plasma membrane, it is present below the cell wall. It is 5 to 10 nanometers thick. It is a lipoproteinaceous membrane, means it will have lipids and proteins. And proteins are of two types, peripheral and integral proteins. Peripheral means on the outer side they are present. Integral means they are present inside the membrane. Okay, trilaminar unit membrane structure is given. Phospholipids have charged polar ends and non-polar tail. Here you can understand in the structure. Hopanoids provide stability to membrane. In bacteria, hopanoids will be there. And eukaryotic plasma membrane contains sterols and high protein content. So here, this is the difference. Eukaryotic plasma membrane will have sterols, and prokaryotic plasma membrane will have hopanoids. So this is the integral proteins, and this is the peripheral protein. Integral protein, peripheral protein, and along with this proteins, there will be lipids. These are the lipids. This is the polar and non-polar region of the lipid. Polar head, non-polar tails. Okay, two layers of lipids are there. And these are called structures, specialized structures present in the prokaryotic membrane, that is hopanoids. They give stability to the membrane. So these are sterol-like molecules present in the bacteria. They are made from the same precursor as steroids, and they provide stability. Functions of plasma membrane, they are helping in transportation of nutrients. They have many number of enzymes required for different mechanisms, and electron transport, oxidative phosphorylation, everything is done on this plasma membrane, and it is an attachment site for plasmids and chromosomal DNA for during replication. Whenever replication is being done, they attach to this plasma membrane. Next, mesosomes. You know, plasma membrane invaginates into the cell, forming a round structures called as mesosomes, and they help in cell wall formation, cell division, chromosome replication. But scientists have found that these mesosomes are formed when during staining processes. So they are not sure whether they are integral part of the bacteria or they are formed during special conditions. Next, ribosomes. You know what are the type of bacteria, ribosomes present in bacteria? It is 70S type. 70S type will have the subunits 50S and 30S. And ribosomes will have ribosomal RNA and proteins. Okay, RNA consists of 60% weightage, and proteins are 40% in ribosome. So this is the eukaryotic ribosome. This is the prokaryotic ribosome. Prokaryotes is 70S ribosome, eukaryotes have 80S ribosome, and these are the subunits, and these are the RNA and proteins. 30S will have 16S rRNA plus 21 proteins. 50S subunit will have 23S rRNA plus 5S rRNA plus 31 proteins. So this also you have to remember. They can ask where, in which part of the ribosome is 16S rRNA present. You have to answer it as 30S subunit. So you have to have some idea what component is having which type of RNA. Hope I am clear here. Diameter is 200 angstroms of this ribosome. So these are electron microscopic structures, nucleoid. In the central part of the bacteria, we'll have a genetic material called as nucleoid, and it is having double-stranded DNA. Here in this nucleoid, 30% RNA and 10% proteins are also there. Proteins present here are HUNS and DNA binding protein 2. These are histone-like proteins. Bacteria lack introns and histones. So what are introns? Exons are introns and exons. You have to understand the terminology. Exons are coding sequences. Introns are non-coding sequences. In eukaryotic cells, introns are present, but in prokaryotes, introns are absent. So supercoiling in bacteria, this is the genome. It is coiling like this, like a flower, and then supercoiling will be done. Next is plasmid. These are extra chromosomal DNA present in the cell. Size and number varies. Like many plasmids may also be present. Size also differs. It helps in the presence of antibiotics or stress-related genes. And they help in transferable recombinant DNA technology. You know about rDNA technology. Mostly plasmids are used there. And copy number can be 1 to 100. And it can be stringent or relaxed. Number may be same or it can be changed. And episomes, F plasmid, R plasmid, all are there. So these are different types of plasmids are there. And this is the plasmid, whatever you have seen just now. See, this is the plasmid. So plasmids can be episomes, which can integrate into the main genome. They are called as episomes. F plasmids, R plasmids, and col plasmids are different types of plasmids. Next. So functions of plasmids. They are helpful in making toxins. They are helpful in resisting the environment, and they help in resisting of various antibiotics. They use unusual chemical compounds as nutrients. Means for degradation of different chemicals or different pesticides, these plasmids will help. Specialized cell structures, what are they? Storage granules. PHP granules are there. They are compact structures. They do not have any membranes. It will consist of specific substance like glycogen, polyphosphate, sulfur granules. Means whatever granules you are seeing now, if you are saying PHB, it is having that compound, polyhydroxybutyrate. If it is sulfur granules, it is having sulfur component, right? So for polyphosphate granules are also called as volutin granules or metachromatic granules. Gas vacuoles will be there. They are permeable to atmospheric gas. They are membrane-bound structures, and aquatic photosynthetic bacteria and cyanobacteria, these gas vacuoles can be seen and regulate the depth at which they float. If they are present in the water bodies, these gas vacuoles will help in floating for the cell. And carboxysomes, they are polyhedral or hexagonal bodies. In these, they'll have some enzymes like RUBP, RUBP carboxylase, etc. And magnetosomes, they'll have this magnetite material, and they will show this, what do you say, pole movement. They'll help in movement, magnetotaxis. These are the examples. They are present in heads of birds, dolphins, tuna, to understand the direction. These magnetosomes are present. See this chain. Next, endospores. Endospores here, they are having limited supply of carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, and endospore in gram-positive. Endospores are resistant structures, basically. They'll show sporulation. These are the examples, and they resist heat, radiations, chemical disinfectants, and desiccation. Spore means resistant structure to survive unfavorable conditions. Shape, it can be oval, ellipsoidal, or spherical for the spore, and position can be terminal, subterminal, or central. And these are the content present, DNA, RNA, enzymes, etc. present. And 10 to 30% of water is present in endospore. Proteins are also present. They are called as SASPs, small acid soluble spore proteins, SASP, small acid soluble spore proteins are present in where? Endospores. They bind to DNA and they help the cell, or they help the DNA to protect from UV desiccation or dry heat. Next, this is the endospore. You can see central subterminal terminal. This is the parent cell. This is the endospore. If you see the cell spore, this is the exospore and this is the spore coat. This is the plasma membrane cortex, right? This is the new bacteria. Whenever the favorable conditions return, the spore will germinate and the cell will release. Vegetative cell will come out. This endospore staining can be done by malachite green. And coming to growth, cell increases in number. As we grow in height and weight, but cells grow in number. Bacteria will grow in number. This is the logarithmic fashion. One will become two, two will become four. And generation time is 15 minutes to few hours. For different bacteria, generation time is different. And it differs with nutritional and environmental conditions. And this is the growth curve, lag phase, log phase, stationary phase, and death phase. Different phases are there. And coming to the reproduction, it can be asexual or sexual. Asexual reproduction in bacteria is by binary fission and endospore formation. And sexual reproduction is by conjugation, transduction, and transformation. This is also can be asked. Asexual reproduction in bacteria can be done by mainly by binary fission. Then endospore is also helping. Sexual reproduction is by conjugation, transduction, and transformation. So what is transformation? Just if a cell is taking up a DNA piece or DNA segment from the external environment and getting integrating this into the genome, then it is called as transformation. Next is conjugation. A part of genetic material, that plasmid, is transferred to another cell, that is through sex conjugation tube. Okay, that is conjugation. And then transduction means it is the transfer of the genetic material through viruses or bacteriophage. Okay, it will infect this bacteria, it will release that genome. Viral genome is entering into the cell, it will take control of the bacterial genome. And then what happens? It will synthesize viruses, but a part of bacterial genome is entering into the virus. This virus will again infect the new cell. Then this the bacterial gene from this bacteria is entering into this bacteria. So this transfer of gene genetic material by viruses is called as transduction. Okay, nutrition. They can be different types. If they are using light, they are phototrophs. If they are using chemical energy, they are chemotrophs. Right? Phototrophs are nothing but autotrophs. Chemotrophs, they can be lithotrophs or organotrophs. Lithotrophs means inorganic substances. Right? Electronic sources, inorganic one. Organotrophs means they are using organic sources. And lithotrophs, if they utilize carbon source and carbon dioxide, again, they can be autotrophs. Means they are, autotrophs are nothing but they are synthesizing their own food. Okay. So economic importance, they are helping in nutrition cycling, agriculture, nitrifying bacteria, industry, medicine, and biotechnology areas. And harmful effects, they are, you know very well, they are causing many diseases. They are spoiling the food. Denitrification, loss of fertility, denitrification. One bit they have asked, which in which activity the bacteria is making the soil to lose the fertility. That is denitrification. Pathogenic bacteria, plants, they are causing many diseases. Okay, so these are all the harmful effects. So here we are ending this class today. So tomorrow, what you have to do is you have to practice all the bits of this topic, that is bacteria, and then we can discuss tomorrow. Shall I end the class? Somebody can. Shall we end the class?
Yes, ma'am. थैंक यू मैम.
ओके यू मैम.
ओके राइट.